How do humans contribute to climate change? Can we and should we adapt to it? Will mitigating it force us to transform our socio-economic model? Climate change is possibly the most important challenge humanity has ever faced. First, because it requires collective action on a global scale, and second, because of its long-lasting effects.
The carbon dioxide we put in the air from burning fossil fuel, a substantial fraction of it will still be there for thousands of years. We are making decisions today that will affect the Earth, not just for our children and our grandchildren, but literally for thousands of generations of humans to come.
It's precisely for that reason that an understanding of its principles, the science that underpins it, and the key questions surrounding the topic raised in scientific, socioeconomic, and technical material, and even within political discussions, become of crucial importance.
Hay soluciones que hoy ya están disponibles y otras que probablemente no, pero empezar a trabajar sobre ellas nos permitirá acelerar el ritmo de descarbonización y también, evidentemente, la capacidad de construir resiliencia frente a los impactos del cambio climático.
The Naturgy Foundation and the Universidad Polytechnic de Madrid, in collaboration with Harvard University, has published a book containing the main scientific basis and issues to be debated around climate change, one of the 9 most important processes for the balance of the Earth system, known as planetary boundaries.
Our planetary system is highly interrelated and complex. We need to develop holistic knowledge of the interrelation of the climate system with the terrestrial biosphere, the water cycle, the oceans, and ice masses through the many processes and instances of feedback that can amplify climate change.
Earth will continue to warm as long as humans continue to emit greenhouse gases above the adequate value for life on Earth. Today, their concentration in the Earth's atmosphere is so high that they trap some of the solar radiation the planet receives that would normally bounce off into outer space. This greenhouse effect heats the Earth's surface and the layer of atmosphere that is in contact with it, the troposphere. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, collects all the science-based studies on this effect. Its reports warn that the effects of this warming can probably not be stopped, but at best mitigated, and that humanity must start now to find the best way to adapt.
Carbon dioxide increases in the atmosphere because we burn fossil fuels. And as we expel it, part of it is absorbed by the plants or by the ocean, but they cannot take up everything, so the temperature increases.
We are dealing here with phenomena that range from decades to millennia, so it's very difficult. But you have many different observational data sets that are completely independent, and all of them are pointing into the same direction. You can see that there is an equivocal evidence.
Science should reduce the uncertainties around climate change, but its effects are increasingly visible, with extreme events such as cold and heat waves, droughts or hurricanes. Temperatures are rising, and more glacier ice is melting every year.
In the 90s, sea level was rising at about 3 millimeters per year. In the last 5 years, it is at 5 millimeters per year.
The reduction of greenhouse gas emissions will be necessary, but not sufficient. Governments will have to prepare themselves to mitigate the foreseeable and inevitable impacts, and even to take advantage of the opportunities that this adaptation process will offer.
We need to act, and we have a roadmap, the Paris Agreement, that is feasible and smart, because it generates direct economic savings and a lot of co-benefits like air quality improvements, creation of jobs, and additional health benefits, which are extremely relevant even more in this pandemic situation.
Adapting to climate change involves transformational and systemic processes, aligning lifestyles with the planet's natural systems, and will last so long that it is likely to become a new norm for future generations.
So what we need, I believe, is adaptation that is synergetic and transformative, synergetic in the sense of generating co-benefits, but also synergetic in transforming the way in which we integrate and adapt to climate change with other socioeconomic needs in making the world better. Not only in seeking the co-benefits of less pollution, but also in creating adaptation strategies that at the same time address basic needs, and also to make sure that we sort of seek for change that is non-linear, that can create rapid transformation, because we don't really have a lot of time.
One of the alternatives to reduce the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere is the capture and storage of CO2. This gas can be absorbed at source, in industry itself, directly from the atmosphere or indirectly through photosynthesis. For storage, the most consolidated strategy is the injection of CO2 in fluid form in deep geological formations. But these processes are still expensive, and today they only manage to capture 0.075% of global emissions. Their future will depend on the development of policies aimed at their implementation.
So we all know what a barrel is. So 140 million barrels of compressed CO2 per day. That is about twice the amount of oil that circulates through the globe daily. And this gives you a sense of what scale is needed.
About one third of our greenhouse gas emissions can be classified as very difficult to mitigate. These emissions will require innovative solutions. This is where carbon capture can play a leading role. We're going to need all sorts of new infrastructure. If we're going to do carbon capture and storage, we're going to need infrastructure. Europe's talking very much about hydrogen. Well, if you're going to start having hydrogen as an energy carrier, you need infrastructure.
But humankind will need to move from incremental solutions to transformational changes that address the root of the problem. The solutions will not only be technological, but systemic, rethinking cities, the industrial and agricultural value chains, the financial system, and the very foundations of the economy.
Designing for resilience, or achieving resilience, adaptation, decarbonization by design and not by disaster. We need to go back to our root causes, and we need to think, how do we institutionalize hope and care as our root design principles for everything else that we build on top of it, in terms of economic flows, in terms of stocks, in terms of assets, in the ways in which we think about human society. That's going to require us to rethink governance, because the economics of scale are the economics that dominate our world.
The green economy should prioritize decarbonization and social contribution. The human identity itself will have to be redefined, abandoning anthropocentrism. This means ceasing to consider the world as a mere resource and formulating a vision of interdependence, where species depend on each other and where it is essential to take care of the ecosystem. a change that will only be possible through a transversal effort, with strong collaboration among businesses, research centres, governments, and civil society.
No one country or even group of countries can solve the problem by themselves. This really requires a global commitment, unlike anything we've ever seen before.
So thank you again, all the authors, for this collective effort, an example of the collective action needed to tackle climate change.